Right, so today I'll be talking on this new topic, hyperoxia and its effects in ICU and emergency. So this talk was given in Hyderabad in Jan 2019. So just to go to the background, I think we need to understand that oxygen that we give in any patient should be in context. Usually it is in the context of hypoxemia. So, and typically we give in patient with a myocardial infarction or acute coronary syndrome. And I think oxygen constitutes one of the components of MONA. So M stands for morphine, O is oxygen, N is nitrates and aspirin. So our understanding is in acute coronary syndrome, oxygen is believed to reduce the size of the infarct. So with that understanding, oxygen is routinely given in patients with acute coronary syndrome. And in patients with stroke, our understanding is there is this area within the stroke which is called penumbra, which is a salvageable area. And our understanding is by giving oxygen that we will be able to reduce the size of this penumbra. And penumbra, by reducing the size of the penumbra, so there is a favorable effect on the progress or outcome in stroke patients. So our understanding is giving oxygen reduces this penumbra size, and so the deleterious effects of stroke would be mitigated. And we have further understood that giving oxygen in patients with skin and soft tissue infections will also facilitate recovery by inhibiting the release of this reactive oxygen species from the neutrophils or inflammatory cells. So, given this background, considering that oxygen is protective in these conditions, in acute coronary syndrome or in strokes or in skin and soft tissue infections, so we need to understand that there are a lot of deleterious effects of oxygen. So, the potential deleterious effects of oxygen is it can cause cerebral vasoconstriction, and that may lead to hypoxemia and the further deleterious effects. So I think we have understood that giving supplemental oxygen can cause cerebral vasoconstriction, and that may lead to deleterious effects. And so giving oxygen I think can lead to worsening of fibrosis and may delay extubation also. So that also has been found. And as I said, the giving oxygenation causes vasoconstriction in the coronaries also, and that may lead to coronary hypoperfusion, and that may also lead to bad outcomes. So these are some of the deleterious effects of giving oxygen unnecessarily. And we do understand that giving oxygenation or oxygen induces fibrosis, and it can worsen acute lung injury, or it may induce acute lung injury, and there may be atelectasis also that may be induced due to oxygen. So these are some of the deleterious effects of giving oxygen. So this is in the face of all the assumed beneficial effects in these conditions of stroke or skin and soft tissue infections or in myocardial infarction or acute coronary syndrome. So what does the current guideline say? The British Thoracic Society in 2017 suggests that in acute illness, saturation has to be maintained between 94% to 98%. And Australia, New Zealand Thoracic Society in 2015 suggests that saturation should be maintained at around 96% in critically ill patients. And the range they give is 92% to 96%, and that gets grade C recommendation. So when you look at the animal studies, I think this was a study which came from the Canadian group. So it was found that increase in the oxygenation leads to worsening of the sepsis and the sepsis-induced multi-organ dysfunction. And why does this happen? Because it is found that oxygenation causes production of these variables, reactive oxygen species, interleukin-6 and interleukin-10 production increases. And this leads to worsening of the multi-organ dysfunction. So these are all the animal studies, and this was also an animal study where they showed sublethal hyperoxia has deleterious effects on the structural and functional aspects of the alveoli. So they have found that the foamy macrophage production is affected, by giving increased oxygen levels. So when you give increased oxygen, there is a lot of foamy macrophage production, and there is a lot of structural and functional changes that happen at the alveolar level. And this has been shown to increase the risk of pneumonia and subsequent mortality. So these were all sort of physiological studies where they've shown that oxygen can have deleterious effects. So this was a study that came from the German group, where they found that the neutrophils, along with the Kupffer cells, so they lead to activation of oxidation within the tissue, and this leads to tissue injury. So these were all the deleterious effects that was found in physiological models or animal models. So where they found that the cellular level oxygen can be deleterious, so they can have effect on the alveolar cells, and they can have effect of that with the oxidation and tissue injury, and they can lead to worsening of sepsis and sepsis-induced multi-organ dysfunction due to release of these interleukins and reactive oxygen species. So then we'll get into the clinical studies. So this was a study that came by Australian group in 2015, where they looked at comparing oxygen versus no oxygen in myocardial infarction. So the question we have in mind is that in patients with ST elevation MI who are not hypoxic, whether giving supplemental oxygen leads to reduce in the infarct cells. And this was our hypothesis, that giving oxygenation in acute coronary syndrome reduces the infarct syndrome in infarct size. So this study was to exactly look at whether giving oxygen had any bearing on the infarct size. So this was a multicentric prospective randomized controlled trial. So this study was done in 9 hospitals in Australia between 2011 to 2014. So this was an AVOID study. So the inclusion criteria was patients more than 18 years, patients who had angina lasting for about 12 hours, and who had pre-hospital ECG evidence of ST elevation MI. So exclusion criteria were patients who were already hypoxemic or who had bronchospasm, because obviously when someone is hypoxemic, you cannot enroll into this study, who had bronchospasm requiring oxygen and salbutamol, or who needed oxygen before randomization, and who were in altered conscious state. So these were the exclusion criteria. So the eligible patients with chest pain in this particular Australian study was 836 patients. So 218 patients were randomized to oxygen arm and 223 to no oxygen arm. So the oxygen arm received, irrespective of their saturation, they received 8 liters per minute of oxygen, and no oxygenation arm received saturation, I mean received oxygen only when saturation was less than 94%. And even when saturation was less than 94%, they received oxygen through nasal prongs at 4 liters, vis-à-vis the control arm, which got oxygen at 8 liters per minute. So the primary outcome of this study was to look at injury to the myocardial muscle by measuring cardiac troponin and CPK. So this was the way the injury to the myocardium was measured in this study. And the cardiac troponin and creatinine kinase was measured at the baseline, was measured 6 hourly for 24 hours, and subsequently it was measured for 12 hourly to 72 hours to see the rise in cardiac troponin in both groups. And for all the patients, cardiac MRI was done at 6 months to look at the extent of myocardial injury. So what was the results? So if you look at the results, this was a very positive study which sort of negates the use of oxygen in acute coronary syndrome. So if you look at oxygen group 218, the peak creatinine kinase was very high, 1948, as opposed to the no oxygen group, where the creatinine kinase was much lesser, and that was statistically significant. And our understanding is that your cardiac or myocardium injury was more when in the oxygen group. And they looked at secondary outcomes. I think the secondary outcomes are even more profound. If you look at recurrent MI at discharge, it was more in oxygen group, 5.5 versus 0.9, that was statistically significant. If you look at arrhythmias at discharge, it was more in oxygen group as compared to no oxygen, statistically significant. If you look at recurrent MI at 6 months, it was more in oxygen group compared to no oxygen group, that was statistically significant. And if you look at median infarct size, which they looked by doing cardiac MRI at 6 months, I think the infarct size was much bigger when you gave oxygen as opposed to the group we did not get oxygen, that was statistically significant. And if you look at major adverse cardiac events at 6 months, even that was. So this was a very striking sort of a study, which points out to the deleterious effects of oxygen. At least if you want to vouch for this study, it says oxygen was dangerous. It sort of worsened the outcomes when you look at the infarct size or major adverse cardiac events or recurrent MI, and even the myocardial injury was found to be more. So the conclusions of this study was routine oxygen therapy did not, so there was no benefit in reducing the size of the infarct size, did not improve hemodynamics or did not alleviate the symptoms. So there was absolutely no benefit in routine oxygen therapy. In fact, what routine oxygen therapy did was increase the myocardial injury, as was evidenced by rise in the cardiac troponin and CPK. So I think that was the conclusions of this particular study, that oxygen was not beneficial in any way. If at all, it was deleterious in increasing the myocardial injury. So after this study, so the Swedish group came out with a similar trial in ST elevation MI called SOCCER trial. So this SOCCER trial took ST elevation MI patients with normoxia. So normoxia was defined as saturation more than 94%, and they were randomized in ambulance to oxygen group and room air group. So the oxygen group got, irrespective of the saturation, got oxygen or oxygenation at 10 liters, and the treatment group or the study group got no oxygen unless saturation was less than 90%. And all these patients in both groups underwent percutaneous interventions, and all these patients underwent cardiac MRI at day 2 and day 6. So it's a little similar to the previous study where they looked at cardiac injury with cardiac MRI. And here they came out with unique scores. So they came out with these three scores called myocardium at risk score and injury severity score and myocardium salvage index, which was calculated as 1 minus injury severity divided by myocardium at risk into 100. So these were the measures to identify the myocardium which was injured. So these were the study endpoints. So the primary endpoint was to look at myocardial salvage index, which is calculated with this formula. And the secondary outcome was to look at myocardium at risk and injury scores. So this was the first study, if at all, to look at effect of oxygen on this myocardium salvage index, myocardium at risk and injury score. So the eligible patients were 229 patients. So this was a little smaller study than the previous one. The oxygen group, there were 46 patients in oxygen group and 49 in the room air group. So if you look at the results, as you see, the myocardium at risk, this is the oxygen group, and myocardial salvage index was more in oxygen group, but that was not statistically significant in this group. So if you look at myocardium salvage index, so as you see, it was little more, but these were not statistically significant. So the conclusions from this SOCCER trial was, in patients who are normoxemic with ST elevation MI, oxygen, when you compare oxygen supplementation versus room air, so there was no effect. So there was no bearing on myocardial salvage index, myocardium at risk or injury score. So this is in comparison to the Australian study, where if you give oxygen, it showed that there is increase in the infarct size and there is more myocardium injury. But at least this study is a non-inferior study, where it says there is no deleterious effect, but there is no benefit. So you would have expected this myocardium at risk or injury score or salvage index to have been better, but it was not better and it was not worse. So it was a non-inferior study. So, and but what this study highlights is, it just raises the question of safety of withholding routine supplemental oxygen in patients with ST elevation. So this basically highlights the point that you don't routinely have to give oxygen in patients with myocardial infarction who are normoxemic. So this was another study which again came from the Swedish group by Hoffman et al. In 2017. So oxygen therapy in suspected acute myocardial infarction. So this included patients with suspected MI with normoxemia, whose saturation was more than 90%, and they were randomized to oxygen supplementation and ambient air. So oxygen supplementation in this study, they got 6 liters per minute as opposed to the 8 liters and 10 liters in the previous study via face mask for 6 to 12 months and ambient air. So this was a multicentric open label registry randomized controlled trial where they got all the data from SWIDHEART. SWIDHEART is the database of all the acute coronary syndrome patients. So this was sort of a retrospective sort of a study, but they took the data from that SWIDHEART database and then they analyzed the data. So this looked at 35 sort of hospitals in Sweden between 2013 to 2015. So the primary endpoint was all-cause mortality in 365 days, and the secondary endpoints was all-cause mortality at 30 days and patients needing hospitalization due to MI or due to heart failure or the cardiac death that occurred, and composite endpoints at 30 days and 365 days. So basically they took all the data in the Swedish registry of patients who had acute coronary syndrome, and they looked at oxygen supplementation in this group, and they looked at these primary endpoints and secondary endpoints. So the total patients randomized from this registry was 6,629 patients. So 3,301, 11 patients were in oxygen group, so who had received oxygen, and 3,318 were the patients who had not received oxygenation. They were on ambient air. So these were all in retrospect. They were these were all the retrospect data which they analyzed prospectively by randomization, and they looked at how these patients did. So if you look at the results, as you see, the all-cause mortality at 365 days, there was no difference between patients who received oxygen and no oxygen. And all-cause mortality at 30 days, there was no difference in patients who received oxygen and who did not receive. The P was not statistically significant. And rehospitalization due to MI, there was no difference between patients who received oxygen who did not receive oxygen. Composite endpoints at 30 days, there was no difference. Composite endpoints at 365 days, there was no difference. And median highest cardiac troponin also there was no difference. So this was also a non-inferior study. So the conclusions again, so this was very similar to the previous soccer study where they say routine supplemental oxygenation in suspected MI did not have any mortality benefit at 1 year. So basically there was no benefit. So it is very akin to the soccer trial. Soccer trial was a prospective randomized controlled trial, but this was, they took all the data from the SWIDHEART group over 3 to 4 years, then they randomized and they saw whether it made. So even when you looked at this, so the routine oxygen supplementation in MI who were not hypoxemic did not have any benefit. So this was also non-inferior study. So then we'll move to, so we saw three studies. One was the Australian study, which was hugely positive, which basically said giving oxygen is deleterious in patients with MI, followed by two Swedish study which said it did not have any benefit, neither did it do any harm. So we'll move to this neurology section. So this was a study which came in JAMA 2017 to look at routine oxygenation in patients with stroke patients. So the question we have in mind is, in patients with stroke, giving routine oxygenation, whether it reduces this penumbra. Penumbra, as we understand, is an area which is salvageable. So the hypothesis is, by giving oxygen, we'll be able to salvage this penumbra, without which this penumbra will become non-viable. So whether it leads to improved functional outcome. So this was a multicentric randomized controlled trial done in UK in 136 hospitals. They did 1:1:1 randomization. So the primary outcome was to look at modified Rankine score at 90 days and disability range. So this range was defined from score of 0 to 6, where 0 is no symptoms and 6 is death. So they randomized 8,003 patients were randomized. So they were randomized into three groups. The first group, the number of patients randomized were 2,668 who got continuous oxygen day and night. The second group was 2,667 patients who got only nocturnal oxygen, who got oxygen only at night. And 2,668 patients who was a control group who did not get oxygen unless they were hypoxemic. These were all stroke patients. So if you look at the results, very interesting. So when you look at modified Rankine score between the continuous oxygen and control group, so there was no difference. And when you compare modified Rankine score between nocturnal oxygen and control group, there was no difference. And if you compare between continuous oxygen and nocturnal oxygen, there was no P was not significant. So which means to say there was no benefit between either of the group. You give either continuous oxygen or give only oxygen at the night or no oxygen. There was no difference between these three groups with regards to functional outcome, which was measured by modified Rankins. But when you looked at mortality also, between continuous oxygen and control group, there was no difference in mortality. Nocturnal oxygen and continuous and control group, no difference. And if you compare continuous oxygen and nocturnal oxygen, there was no difference in mortality. As you see, the hazard ratios around hovering around 1. All the hazard ratios are hovering around 1. So the conclusions they made from this particular study from UK was, in patients who had a stroke and who are non-hypoxic, giving low dose oxygen supplementation as a routine did not reduce death, did not reduce disability at the end of 3 months. So in stroke patients, our assumption that giving routine oxygenation will mitigate this penumbra or will reduce the size of penumbra is superfluous, and it did not confer any benefit. So, and do not support low dose oxygen supplementation. So this was the conclusions from this study. So then came this big study, which was a stupendously positive study in critical ill. The effect of conservative versus conventional oxygen on mortality among all patients in intensive care unit. So we looked at cardiac patients, 3 studies, 1 from Australia, 2 from Sweden. Then we looked at UK study, which looked at stroke patients. This was an Italian study which took all patients who were admitted in ICU, which was called oxygen ICU randomized clinical trial. So the question we have in mind critically ill is, whether do all critically ill patients need oxygen? So they compared conservative oxygen therapy versus liberal oxygen therapy and its effect, whether it reduces mortality in all intensive care patients. So this was an Italian study. It was a single center, open label, randomized control trial done in Italy between 2010 to 2012. So on admission into ICU, they randomized into 2 groups, 1:1. So control group was the conventional, where irrespective of their oxygenation, they got oxygen, they were given oxygen. The protocol was the conservative group, we did not get oxygen. So the control group got FiO2 of at least 0.4, 40%, and PaO2 was maintained even up to 150, and saturation target was 97 to 100%. In the protocol, the FiO2 was maintained at the least possible level, so that PaO2 is maintained only 70 to 100 and saturation is 94 to 98%. So the inclusion criteria was, they took patients who were older than 18 years and admitted to ICU with expected length of stay of more than 72 hours. And they excluded patients with ARDS, where PF ratio is less than 150, and COPD patients. Or they excluded patients who were readmitted to ICU or who were identified as end of life sort of a patients. And they even excluded neutropenic patients. So the primary outcome was to look at ICU mortality. The secondary outcome was to look at new organ failures and new infections in these patients. So results were very striking and very remarkable. So if you look at ICU mortality, the conservative group is which did not get oxygen, where oxygenation was maintained at a very low level, at an acceptable low level. So ICU mortality was low when you compare to the conventional group, where they got liberal oxygen. So I will call conventional as liberal. So the ICU mortality was high, and that was statistically significant. So if you look at the Kaplan-Meier survival curve, so you see this is a liberal oxygen where survival was much lower. So if you look at new, this was the secondary outcome results. When you look at new organ failure, so if you see, this is a liberal oxygen, the blue one is a liberal oxygen. The new organ failures also was more in liberal oxygen group. So if you look at shock was more in liberal, 10.6 versus 3.7, statistically significant. If you look at organ dysfunction, they looked at liver dysfunction was more in liberal oxygen group when compared to the conservative group, and that was statistically significant. And when you look at new infection rates, again the blue is the liberal oxygen, new infections also. If you look at bacteremia is more in liberal oxygen group when compared to the conservative group, that was statistically significant. And even if you look at ventilatory free days, it was much better. Ventilation free days was high, which is good in liberal group, in conservative group when compared to conventional group, because conventional group is the liberal group where mechanical ventilatory free days or hours was lesser, and that was statistically significant. So this was a very striking study which really points to the deleterious effects of oxygenation in general ICU patients. So which is again a very sort of a, it really emphasizes the importance of not oxygenating intensive care patients unnecessarily, because the infection risk was more, organ failure rates was more, even mortality was more if we gave more oxygen in the patients. And this is an interesting table I want you to focus. So if you took all patients, as I said, the liberal group had higher liberal group, as you see, has a higher mortality of 44 as compared to the conservative group. But what is striking is then they stratified intubated patients and non-intubated patients. So if you look at intubated patients, the liberal group had higher mortality, 40 in 148 died, when compared to the restrictive group, which were 23 out of 143 dead, that was statistically significant. But when you took non-intubated patients and you compared between the liberal and conservative, there was no statistically significant difference between the mortality. So which again highlights that in intubated patients, we should be all the more worried about not maintaining higher oxygenation. That's what this study emphasizes. And the conclusions in this study was, in critically ill patients, conservative versus liberal. So we understand that liberal oxygen increases mortality and conservative oxygenation reduces the mortality. So that was the conclusion of this study. So if we do not believe in this Italian study, then the nail on the coffin or icing on the cake was this IOTA study. So this was the biggest sort of a systematic review of all the studies, which came as latest as Lancet 2018. So this was a combined study from the Canadian group and Australian group. So this was a systemic, it's a meta-analysis, systematic review of all the studies. So they took 25 randomized controlled trials with 16,037 patients. This was the largest study to look at what is going to be the final say with regards to oxygenation. So they took all the patients. So we had one study from Australia and two Swedish study in cardiac patients. We had one UK study on the stroke patients, and we had Italian group in general ICU. So this really takes in all those studies. So it takes stroke patients 7,795, and it takes MI patients 6,306 MI patients, and general critical care patients 582, sepsis 50, and emergency surgery. So it really encompasses all the sorts of patients that we tend to see in ICU. And look at the results. This results also is very striking. If you look at hospital mortality, in the liberal group, it was more when compared to the conservative oxygen, that was statistically significant, and the number needed to treat was 143. When you look at 30-day mortality, liberal oxygen group had more 30-day mortality when compared to conservative oxygen, that was statistically significant. Number needed to treat was 125. And mortality at longest follow-up was again more in liberal oxygen group compared to conservative oxygen group, and that was also statistically significant. So this is the sort of a study which tends to summarize the finding of all the previous studies, and this is the latest that we can vouch for. And if you look at it, really takes in all those studies that we have discussed, and it really shows that more oxygenation is bad. And what further they looked into this study was, they did a meta-regression analysis, and what they found is there is a linear correlation between increase in saturation and relative risk of in-hospital mortality. So this is what they found, that there is a linear correlation that the higher the saturation, I think it has a bearing on relative risk in hospital mortality. And they even showed that saturation has a dose-dependent effect on mortality risk. And they even went on to show that 1% increase in saturation, more than 96%, was shown to attribute to 25% increase in the risk of mortality. So this was the striking message that came out of this study. And when they looked at the median oxygenation, that liberal group, in this particular study, they saw the median oxygenation that patients had was 0.52, and this 52%, the median duration was for 8 hours. So in this particular study, I think the median duration of FiO2 in liberal group was about 50%, and that remained for around 8 hours as a median duration. And the base, when they looked at baseline median saturation, it was around 96.4%, and range was from 94% to 99%. When you looked at conservative group, the median FIO2, look at the median FIO2 in conservative, it was only 21%. So what this study emphasizes is, if someone on a ventilator, I think we all agree that we keep 40 as a standard if they're maintaining 100%. I think this study really showcases that if they're maintaining 100% on 40, you can tend to come down to even up to 21% if needs be when they're on ventilator, and try to maintain saturation at around 96%. You don't need to maintain 100% and keep 40 as our baseline. So you can come down on the baseline to even up to 21, because if you look at in the conservative, the median FiO2 that was given was 21%. So the conclusions they made in this study was, systematic review and meta-analysis is a high quality evidence which really highlights the point that hyperoxia is life-threatening. And even it goes on to say in conclusions, if you treat 71 patients with liberal oxygen, you will be causing one death. So that is the sort of an impact of hyperoxia. So the take-home message for all my good friends is, oxygen is a drug. It is not a routine, simple thing that you give. It needs to be prescribed with care, and prescription has to be done with care. And whilst you are prescribed, it is extremely important to monitor the trends of oxygenation, because we know that excess also causes harm, and inadequate oxygenation also causes harm. And our first gospel is, first do no harm. So any acutely ill patients, it doesn't mean routine oxygenation has to be given. So in acutely ill or emergency, routine oxygenation, even if they're maintaining good saturation, we need to understand it is not safe, it is unsafe. And supplemental oxygenation could be considered if saturation is less than 94%. But when you start oxygenation, aim to target saturation between 94 to 96 and not more than that. That is extremely important. And obviously, you would give oxygen when someone is cyanosed. And this IOTA study, which you saw, which is a meta-analysis, is very similar to other studies that less is more. So, and it's very similar to all the other previous studies, like TRIC study or NICE Sugar, where they really showed that targeting supranormal levels or achieving supranormal physiological endpoints does more harm than any benefit. And this is very similar to all the other previous studies where we have understood that targeting supranormal levels of any of the physiological endpoints are disastrous or leads to more ominous endpoints. So I think what is now keenly awaited is this new study, ICO ROCK study, which is being conducted by ANZICS Group. This is a randomized controlled trial with sample size of more than 1,000 patients that is being conducted. Results are meant to be out. So I think we would be very keen to see what the results of this study would be. But like any other ANZICS study, I would sort of assume that this study will show no difference between oxygen versus no oxygen, because that's typically most of the Australian studies come out with that sort of the findings. So thank you very much. So I'll end this with a anecdotes that oxygen is a big deal and oxygen is overrated. So thank you very much.